Hi everyone, my name is Dr. Fuad Al-Khoury. I am a urologist based out of Orange County, and today it's my pleasure to discuss percutaneous nephrolithotomy, also known as PCNL. So today's talk will begin with the definition of PCNL and some of the criteria that I use when I'm determining whether a patient is suitable for the surgery. We'll talk about the lithotripsy energy options, okay, and what we can use to break up the stones. We'll talk about gaining access to the kidney and some techniques that I use. We'll talk about standard PCNL, and we'll also talk about mini PCNL. I'll share with you some of my post-operative management, and we'll discuss some of the complications that urologists that perform PCNL should anticipate and hopefully avoid. So the broad definition of percutaneous nephrolithotomy is essentially when you access the kidney going through the skin. And so we typically access it through the flank and enter the renal collecting system by making a small hole through the renal parenchyma or the kidney tissue. There are many different sizes of the hole that we can use, right? And so there's a standard PCNL, which can range from 24 French to 30 French. There's mini PCNL, which ranges from 16 French to 22 French. And then there's ultra mini and micro PCNL. These are not as commonly seen. They've been described in the literature. They're typically 5 French to 13 French. And the sheaths, in my opinion, are a little bit small to justify going in through the kidney itself, but for some they may be appropriate. So the traditional criteria for PCNL are stones that are larger than 2 centimeters in size. These days we have the thulium laser at our disposal, which typically fragments stones and dusts stones at a much faster rate than holmium lasers have done in the past. And so as a result, there's a growing movement towards using the thulium laser to treat larger stones in the kidney, and you can do that in a retrograde approach using ureteroscopy. However, there's still a major role for PCNL because the stone treatment, the efficiency and the stone free rate are still higher when stones start to grow larger than 2 centimeters when you treat it with a PCNL. It's also useful when there's a challenging lower pole stone, and when you try to treat it with ureteroscopy, you just can't make that turn, right? The ureteroscope can't flex enough to access that lower pole stone, and so PCNL is appropriate for that. And also, some patients have ureteral strictures, or they have a tight UPJ obstruction, and accessing it in a retrograde fashion may be impossible or may be very challenging. And so accessing the stone from a percutaneous approach is more suitable. And so the uses for PCNL, large renal stones, like we discussed, large proximal ureteral stones as well, stones that may be in a calyceal diverticulum, which you cannot access in a retrograde fashion ureteroscopically, because sometimes the diverticulum may be walled off to where you can't find where the entry point is from the renal pelvis. And so accessing the diverticulum percutaneously and perking right into the diverticulum typically works very well. Horseshoe kidneys traditionally have a high insertion of the ureteropelvic junction. And so treating horseshoe kidney stones with PCNL typically is a much more efficient approach, and does usually result in a higher stone free rates. And also upper tract urothelial carcinoma, when appropriate, treating these procedures percutaneously can allow for a more efficient ablation of tumor. So what energy options do we have? So for traditional PCNL, our typical lithotripter of choice is a combination of a pneumatic and ultrasound handpiece. So what this does is it essentially breaks the stone up, and there's a suction attached, and that allows the urologist to suck the stones out as they're being broken up. There's really two lithotripters on the market that are in use today, that are the most commonly used. The first is Olympus Shock Pulse Lithotripter. That's the one that I usually use. And the second is the Boston Scientific Swiss Lithoclast Trilogy. They essentially do the same thing. Okay, they break up stone efficiently, and they suck the stones up very well also. So basically they're very similar machines, and they're both very efficient. The second option during PCNL is to use a laser, right? And you can either use a holmium laser or a thulium laser. This usually comes into play when a stone is in a very hard to reach location and you have percutaneous access. You typically will use the flexible nephroscope, which is essentially a cystoscope, to make your way into the calyx of interest and use a laser to break up the stones. In my practice, I like to use the holmium laser during PCNL because I'm not so much concerned about dusting the stones as small as possible. I care more so about fragmenting the stones and removing them from that calyx, repositioning them to the renal pelvis, and then I can use my suction with my handpiece to remove those pieces. And so I typically use holmium laser when I'm doing a PCNL if I need to use the laser at all. So how about positioning? So when positioning the patient, traditionally speaking, patients are in the prone position. And in my practice, I like to place the patient in a split leg modification. What this allows me to do is to position the patient from the very start of the case and access the bladder in a retrograde fashion using a flexible cystoscope. Now the patient's upside down, so you have to be prepared for some challenges, especially in males, in accessing the bladder. But with good traction on the penis from your assistant, you're able to really straighten out the urethra and enter the bladder successfully. And then I thread a wire up the ureter of interest, just like we do when the patient's in the supine position. Then pass a 5 French redural catheter over that, and that's what I use to distend the renal pelvis, to shoot contrast for a retrograde pyelogram to help me with access later on. Some hospitals don't have a split leg attachment to the bed, and so traditionally we would do flexible cystoscopy in the gurney after intubation, and then we would flip the patient with the 5 French redural catheter already up in the collecting system. A small note about the gel rolls. I like to put the gel rolls, I guess, transverse across the chest, because they typically will not slide out during the case, and the patients are very well padded. Some urologists like to place the gel rolls up and down. For me, usually with the more obese patients, they will typically, the gel rolls may move, they may slide out, and the patient end up being on their abdomen during the case. And by doing this small modification, the gel rolls won't slide out. There's a growing trend also towards a modified supine PCNL, also known as supine PCNL. And this is essentially a modified lithotomy position where the patient is in dorsal lithotomy and their legs are positioned in a way where the patient's flank can be bumped up with a gel roll, as you can see in this graphic, and the urologist can access the bladder and the kidney both in a retrograde fashion and percutaneously. There are some advantages. So, from an anesthesia standpoint, it's much easier to ventilate a patient when they are supine than if they're prone. And also, having retrograde access, right? Being able to treat the stones as we traditionally do in a retrograde approach, if needed. That's an option that's available to the urologist in the supine PCNL position. However, disadvantages, in my opinion, are that bowel and peritoneum can fall down towards the kidney. And so, if you're gaining access in this position, you do have a higher likelihood of encountering the peritoneum or the bowel. And so definitely ultrasound access would be more advantageous in these settings, and we'll talk about that a little bit later in the presentation. And finally, maneuverability of the scope, right? Being in this position, you have the bed that's very close to where your scope's going to be. And I feel like maneuvering the scope to every aspect of the kidney may be a challenge. So something to keep in mind in this position. Now let's talk about access. So in my practice, I use 99% of the time fluoroscopy to gain access. And what I do is I put up a 5 French ureteral catheter in a retrograde fashion when the patient's in the prone split leg position. And I shoot a retrograde pyelogram to distend the renal collecting system to identify the calyx I want to enter. And I use an 18 gauge Chiba needle, which is essentially a biopsy needle. They come in two sizes, in 15 centimeters long and in 20 centimeters long. And I use the triangulation technique to enter the access, the calyx of interest. The details of gaining access are in a different talk entirely, but very briefly, I do use triangulation to access lower pole calyces, and I use the bullseye technique to access upper pole calyces, and we can talk about that in a different talk in the future. The vast majority of my PCNLs, gaining access to the lower pole because that I feel like that's sufficient to treat the vast majority of stones, and it typically is also safer, right? You avoid a supracostal access, which can increase the risk for damaging the pleura. And there's usually a pretty decent lower pole calyx that you can access, and you can essentially access the entire collecting system from this access point. Ultrasound access is very, very useful, and there's a growing trend towards using ultrasound-only access in order to minimize radiation exposure to both the patient and the urologist. Using ultrasound, you can identify stone and you can use the needle to perk right onto the stone and right into the calyx. And so it's a much more precise way to gain percutaneous access. And it's also really nice because you can visualize bowel and you can visualize pleura and other organs that might be between the skin and the kidney that you should note before you dilate. Now, generally speaking, I think the safest approach and probably the easiest approach for most would be to use a combination of fluoroscopy and ultrasound. You know, admittedly, ultrasound for me is quite challenging. You know, I typically err towards using fluoroscopy because I'm more comfortable with that. And in certain cases, if I'm worried about bowel or any kind of organs that are close to my access point, I will use ultrasound to confirm that I have a clear window. But using fluoroscopy and ultrasound together is undoubtedly the safest approach to gaining access. So now to compare standard PCNL and mini PCNL. So standard PCNL, which if, you know, most of you are already familiar with, is a 24 to 30 French sheath. And to dilate the tract, my preference is to use a balloon dilator, like the one that I've shown here in the picture. And these balloons typically dilate to 30 French, and then you advance the plastic sheath over the balloon, and that's your access. The scopes that we use is typically an offset rigid scope that ranges anywhere from 24 to 26 French. And then I also use a flexible cystoscope, which I use to maneuver in the kidney in places where, you know, the rigid nephroscope can't access. And then in terms of lithotripsy options, we discussed the pneumatic and ultrasound options like the shock pulse or the Trilogy. And I also use a holmium laser, which I prefer over the thulium laser for PCNLs. Now, mini PCNL is very exciting, right? This is probably my favorite surgery in urology because it gives you a lot of the advantages of a standard PCNL with minimize morbidity. So the nice thing about this is that it's really a one-step dilation, right? Once you have access that you like, you typically just take the metal trocar that you can see here in the picture with an outer sheath that goes right over it. And there are markings on the metal sheath, so you know exactly how deep you need to go with the outer sheath. And you should really study this on the back table before you get started so you know what markers you want to look at, because every set is a little bit different. But you have options of 15 to 16 French. So the inner metal trocar is 15 French, for example, and the outer sheath is 16 French. And so it just gives you an idea of how wide the percutaneous tract is going to be. So you can go 15 French to 16 French, or 16.5 to 17.5, or 21 to 22 French. And this is just the Storz set that I typically use. There's also other companies that make sheaths. Now, in my personal practice, if I'm very happy with the access and I'm able to get a wire down the ureter and, you know, I'm set and I'm thrilled, I typically will go with a 21 to 22 French sheath. The reason I do that is because that then allows me to use the flexible cystoscope, or the flexible nephroscope in this case, through that channel, right? And it allows me to more efficiently treat stones and not have to really deal with a flexible ureteroscope, which admittedly in an antegrade approach can be a bit cumbersome. If you do decide to go with the 16.5 or 17.5 sheath, which is the most common sheath that I use, you can't fit a flexible cystoscope in there most of the time, unless there's a smaller version out there. But that being said, the 16.5/17.5 is the one I use most commonly, and I feel like that is a nice balance between really being able to basket a lot of stone out and remove a lot of stone, but also minimize the morbidity to the patient and any renal parenchymal damage. Now, in terms of what lithotripsy options I use for mini PCNL, it's essentially just a laser. So I like to use the holmium laser when I'm treating stones with mini PCNL, and I use it preferentially over a thulium laser, just because I feel like my main goal is to fragment the stones into several small pieces and to remove all the pieces by basketing. Using the thulium laser, in my experience, sometimes works well for certain stones, but sometimes it does also char, and it can cause the case to take longer than expected. So I typically do err on using the holmium laser. There are some small pneumatic lithotripters on the market, essentially a mini version of the shock pulse, but I've never used it personally. Anecdotally, I've heard from colleagues that have used it, and it doesn't seem like it adds much clinical value. The suction device that comes with it typically can get clogged up, and it doesn't typically work very well. So I typically like to use just the lasers. When doing mini PCNL, there's typically a combination of dusting the stone. Once the stone inevitably starts to fragment, I then use the basket to remove the pieces. And I also try to use the Venturi effect. The Venturi effect essentially is when you fill the renal pelvis with fluid or with saline, and then you withdraw your scope, the renal pelvis acts essentially like a small balloon, and that pressure of taking your scope out will then allow the stones to follow you out. And so it's a nice way for you to remove some more stone burden while doing a mini PCNL. There's also some suction axis sheaths on the market, specifically the Clear Petra, which is essentially a sheath. Instead of the metal trocar that we use, it's a plastic sheath that attaches to a suction device. And so when you withdraw your scope, you then put your finger on a valve, for example, and that causes the suction to activate, and then it helps to suck up more stone. And so it does seem like that works well. I have yet to use it in practice, but my colleagues have said that they typically have seen some good effects from that. So what are the advantages of mini PCNL compared to standard? So the top advantage is that there's less bleeding, right? Because you're entering less renal parenchyma, and it's a smaller dilation, you typically don't have as much blood loss as you would with a standard PCNL. And so as a result, visualization is much more clear, And postoperatively, you essentially just worry less about the kidney bleeding compared to when you're doing a standard large sheath PCNL. You have more maneuverability as well. Because the sheath is smaller, the fulcrum of movement in the kidney is more narrow. And so your maneuverability is better. So you're able to move the sheath at wider angles. And as a result, you can access more stones that might be harder to access with a standard PCNL. It's also more forgiving for challenging access. If I'm not sure about my access, or if I'm accessing an area that's a small landing zone, essentially, like a very narrow calyx or a calyceal diverticulum, instead of dilating to 30 French, which can, be a problem if it's not in the right place, I can sometimes access with the 15 or 16 French metal trocar and see how things look once I get there. It is a bit of a risk, but some cases do necessitate that, and using the mini PCNL approach does allow you to have a little bit of a more forgiving experience in case the access is challenging. And also a really nice advantage is that the patients can usually go home the same day versus with standard PCNLs, they typically stay overnight. And so what are my post-op protocols? For standard PCNL, patients do stay overnight for one night usually. In rare instances, they go home the same day, but usually it's an overnight stay. I leave a catheter in overnight to maximally decompress the collecting system and to allow the entry point where I entered the calyx to seal up well without any urine extravasation. My mainstay of pain control is using nonsteroidal anti-inflammatories, but I do also add narcotics for any extreme cases where there may be pain. I keep fluids running at a brisk pace, anywhere from 100 to 125 cc's per hour. I do like to get a low dose stone protocol CT scan on post-op day one in order to ensure that this patient is stone free. And if they're not, then we can game plan for the next steps down the line. I don't typically get any labs, and I do leave a stent in place for 1 week. For the mini PCNLs, they are almost always same day discharges. I do not leave a Foley catheter. I typically send them home with a nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory. I typically use diclofenac at 75 milligrams twice a day on an as-needed basis. And they also can include Tylenol, and they can alternate that throughout the day. And I also just leave a stent after my mini PCNLs. I don't use percutaneous nephrostomy tubes, unless really, really needed. And those are very rare instances where the patient might be very contracted, and it would be very challenging to remove the stent in office, in which case I leave a perc tube and I can remove it in the office much more easily down the line. But usually it's just the stent in place for both standard and for mini PCNLs. So what are some complications that we may face during PCNL? So obviously top of the list is bleeding. You should always talk to patients about the possibility of needing a blood transfusion after a PCNL. Knock on wood, it's pretty rare these days. I typically tell patients less than 5%. In reality, it's less than that. Bleeding during PCNLs is usually self-limiting. What I do is I really hold firm pressure on the flank for 5 minutes after withdrawing my sheath. I feel like just that manual compression can help stop majority of bleeding, and I really hold it there and I watch the clock for 5 minutes. And then I pull my hand off and I make sure that we don't see any bleeding coming out of that incision. Some also use hemostatic agents like FlowSeal, which you can inject on the way out at the very end of the case. I don't typically do that, but that is an option. Infection is another one. I always like to have a preoperative urine culture that's negative. And if it's positive, I do treat with antibiotics and then do another culture to ensure that they have a negative culture prior to surgery. I give appropriate antibiotics during surgery, and I do like to give postoperative antibiotics as well. Despite all of that, there is always a chance that the stone harbors bacteria, that the patient can have an infection postoperatively. So, we need to just anticipate that. A urine leak is possible because you are accessing the kidney percutaneously, Usually we see this more so with the standard PCNLs than with minis. Oftentimes I do anticipate this being a problem if I'm going into thin renal parenchyma, if the patient's kidney is atrophic, for example, or the calyx that I chose to enter has a thin renal parenchyma overlying it. And that does take some studying of the CT scan preoperatively. Or if we find that we perforated the collecting system, which happens and usually heals up well, but we need to recognize and anticipate any problems postoperatively. So in these cases, I leave a Foley catheter for 2 to 3 days. That's usually enough time for the renal collecting system to seal up. And that also depends on your clinical judgment. If you feel like leaving the catheter for a little bit longer, you never really would be faulted for doing that. AV malformations, these are a tricky one. These patients usually look great after surgery and then go home and come back with significant bleeding, with clot retention. And you put a catheter in, you irrigate them out, looks great, looks clear, send them home, come back a day or two later again with clot retention. And so usually these cases, after a PCNL suggests arterial venous malformation, it requires a CT angiogram, and then we have our IR colleagues help us by embolizing the AV malformation to essentially cure the problem. Then finally, injury to adjacent structures, something at the forefront of our minds as we're getting access. If you're accessing at the upper pole, you have to really think about the pleura and also the spleen, the liver on their respective sides. And you also have to think about bowel, right? You have to see how close that bowel is to the kidney. And sometimes you see retrorenal colons as well. So using ultrasound really does help, but also close study of the CT scan preoperatively will help. So in summary, PCNL is a really great surgery that you can have in your armamentarium as a urologist. It does play a major role in kidney stone management, and I really don't think it's going anywhere. Even with the advent of the thulium laser, I do think that there's a major role for treating stones with PCNL, and patients actually do very well, and it's really in their best interest. In comparison of comparing the standard versus mini PCNL, really the nice thing is that you can tailor it to each patient based on their anatomy, based on how much stone they have. And so it really does give us that power to be able to help the patients optimally and really minimize their morbidities. And really, it's most ideal for the urologist to be able to gain access. Understandably, that is probably one of the most technically challenging parts of the case, but a urologist being able to gain access really does optimize outcomes for patients. It prevents them from having to go to IR first, then come to the operating room, and really does give the urologist the decision-making power to be able to decide where they want to enter the kidney, depending on where the stone burden is, to really get a nice calyceal puncture, and to minimize a lot of the comorbidities that may come about from having access that's not ideal. And so I really love doing PCNLs. I would be more than happy to talk to anyone about some more of the nuances of surgery and how to really treat our patients best. Thank you very much. My email address is listed there. Please don't hesitate to email or contact me, and I would love to meet some of you.